Project are holding a counter demonstration. We cannot let that kind of hate go allow Judaism to be used as a political cover for colonization. All across the world, people have taken to the streets to demonstrate their anger and their solidarity with the Palestinian people. But political leaders, from Obama in the U.S. to Putin in Russia, from Hollande in France to Sisi in Egypt, are almost unanimously backing Israel's violence. This is an expression of their commitment to continue buying weapons that are, quote, battle-tested on Palestinian civilians. It is in protection of their economic and political interests in the Middle East. They have once again extended a diplomatic shield to Israel that allows it to act with impunity in complete violation of international law.
We are amongst them, and we are with them, no matter how far we may be. Free, free Palestine!
Free, free Palestine!
Now we're going to have our friends from Affirm speak.
My name is Dorothy Santos. I'm the San Francisco Bay Area Coordinator of Affirm, an anti-imperialist transnational feminist organization. Affirm is here today in San Francisco and has been marching in our chapters across the country for one reason. We believe that our existence is absolutely necessary to the existence of womankind. And what we are seeing here, the images of Palestinian women and children killed by Israeli shrapnel, the outright Israeli government plans to kill Palestinian mothers, is nothing less than genocide of womankind. So you may ask, what are Filipina, Chicana, Lebanese, Korean, Central American, Indian, African American women from Affirm across the country raging about in the streets for Palestine? Why do transnational women like us care about what's happening in Gaza? Our answer is this. If we do not rage in the streets for women, the children of Palestine, we are contributing to our own destruction. Yes. Womankind will not survive if we do not resist globally. And if we have a lot, and there's a lot we are fighting for. We are here today because one Palestinian child has been killed by Israeli military every 3 days since 2000. Since July 6th alone, 80% of Palestinians killed by Israeli strikes have been civilians. 1,361 Palestinians have been injured. More than half have been children and women in the past 10 days. We are here today because 90% of refugee children at U.S.-Mexico border qualify for asylum. They'll either die in our home countries ravaged by U.S.-backed dictators, die crossing the border, or die in Obama's detention centers. We are here because of the 300 Nigerian girls kidnapped and sold into slavery. We are here for the 800 disappeared First Nations women of Canada, raped and murdered. All around the world, womankind is being obliterated. The Zionists that are mercilessly murdering Palestinian women are backed by the same U.S. imperialists that back dictators in Central America who destabilize countries, creating poverty and forcing migration. They're the same people that cover up the genocide of First Nations women, who traffic and prostitute the women of the Philippines, who militarize our families' countries of origin, who treat 70,000 migrants in the U.S. like cattle in hidden detention facilities. We are here today because these are more than just human rights issues. These are women's issues, and that's why we are here, why we're on the mic today. These are our issues. And because it has to do with the genocide of womankind. We women must be on the forefront demanding justice. Our lives, quite literally, depend on it. And as transnational women, we know our lives have always depended on it. We stand here through over 500 years of colonization, through half a century of Israeli occupation, through ongoing systematic killing. Genocide of womankind to say not only have we survived, but that we are determined to truly live. Obama, Netanyahu, Zion Israel, Imperial United States, you can keep killing us, but we promise that it will only flame the rising fire of women's resistance. We know and have always known that our place, a woman's place, is not in the home. It's not in the kitchen. It's not in the bedroom. A woman's place is right here.
Hassan Bezian here to speak for us today.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm speaking today on behalf of the American Muslims for Palestine, the national organization. And today we have rallies across the country in coalition with all the organization and the communities that see the injustice for what it is, a cold-blooded slaughter that is taking place. We can't call this a war. It is not a war between two states. It's a massacre. It's a turkey shoot from an occupier against an occupied population. President Obama, the British Prime Minister, the Canadian up in the north, all speak of Israel's right to defend itself. If they're saying this, they're basically saying that the slave master has the right to punish the slave. It's no different than a slave master that has been in total control of the slave, controlling their daily lives, controlling their food, controlling their airspace, controlling their water, and yet they're dissatisfied because the slave has the temerity to say no, to say, I want to be free. I have a dignity that I want to be free. And therefore, we need to understand what is taking place. This calamity is not of today. This has been 67 years in the making. So when the United States and the Western powers speak of Israel's right to defend themselves, they're speaking about a child that they brought to life in Palestine. And it was the British who took the land from one people, promised to the other, without consulting the Palestinians. Yet it was inherited by the United States. And we need to be very clear about it. They're speaking double and triple speak from all sides of their mouth. If they want the Palestinians to stop resisting, then stop occupying them to begin with. Now I want to speak a little bit in relation to the media. The New York Times, when it covered the murder of the four kids on Gaza Beach playing soccer, the first headline spoke about four kids killed on the beach. Few hours later, that headline was completely changed, and the lead up to the article was completely changed from witnesses saying that Israel killed the children to a complete obfuscation of what takes place. And then they wanted to engage in liberal humanization of the Palestinians, where they began to describe of the kids and what took place. But then they say that their mothers told them not to go outside and play, leaving in the mind of the reader that they should have listened to their mother, not the fact that the military killed four kids playing soccer on the beach. That's what the media makes it possible. NBC had to yank their reporter from the scene, Ayman Muhyiddin, because he also reported the story as a primary witness being on the beach. CNN took their reporter out of Gaza. Israel.
Yes.
We have to stop our debt to Israel. Now some, and I've been hearing some of these statements time and time again, were some ignorant person that have not read history poses the question of where is the Palestinian Gandhi? Where is the Palestinian Gandhi? That is an ignorant statement. They don't understand the difference between colonialism and settler colonialism. Yeah. Settler colonialism wants to commit genocide. And even if we think about where is the Palestinian Gandhi, I tell you where he is. He was slaughtered in Sabra and Shatila. He was killed in Deir Yassin. He was burned to smithereens just that past week. His name might be Muhammad Bakir. His name might be Muhammad Durra. And if there is a Palestinian Gandhi, either he's killed or assassinated, he's rotting in jail or been deported for a long period of time. And further, if you're asking about Palestinian Gandhi, where is Israel Gandhi to meet him halfway? The Gandhi that you send us, the Gandhi you send us comes to us on the top of a tank, flying an F-16, and his name is Bibi Netanyahu, or Lieberman, or Weizmann, or Herzl, all committed to the indigenous people genocide. So don't come out in an ignorant statement asking the victim to come out and present you with a Gandhi. You need to ask the aggressor to stop killing the Palestinians and let them... And let them bring their Gandhi out. Let them bring their Gandhi out. And that's something that they need to answer for, not us as Palestinians or communities that are in solidarity with the Palestinians. Lastly, there are many of us in here today, but we need to translate our strength into harassment of the political leadership, the cowardice leadership in this country and across the world. I would say the following. Our political leadership was born without a spine. We need to give them genetic mutation and constitute a Palestinian spine for them. Yeah. That's what we need to do. We need to harass them. Call in. Next 2 weeks, they will be coming to their offices to sit on their couches and sleep. You need to sit in their offices. Have a sit-in. Have a civil disobedience. Let them drag you down. You are the one that representing justice. They're representing atrocities. You are representing the highest ideals and moral and ethical standing. They're representing bombs and destruction. They're representing the bankers. They're representing the corporations. And it's about time for them to represent all of us. Power for us, power to the people.
Yeah.
I am very optimistic. Even in the middle of the one of the most despicable atrocities that is taking place, I'm very optimistic.
Yes,
what is taking place across the world is undeniable. 100,000 in South Africa in Johannesburg, 100,000 in London just yesterday. In France, in Paris, they actually trumped the French government attempt to silence them and went out in the streets, disrupted the railroad. That's what takes place in Canada. Across many parts of the Muslim world and the Arab world has been silent. And that's something we need to speak about. But in the Philippines, in India, in many parts of the world, people are rising up because they see the dispossession of the Palestinians. It speaks to their own dispossession. Their Palestinian state of powerlessness is reflective of their own powerlessness. And therefore, they're rising up to say that a new day is needed, a new world is needed, and it's not going to come from 10 Downing Street. It's not going to come from the White House. It's not going to come from the Champs-Élysées. It's going to come from all of us coming together and changing, ending military-industrial complex, ending corporate greed and complete dispossession of the people, ending the bad stranglehold on all of us that prevents us from being courageous in making a different world possible. That's us. We need to make it possible, and don't allow them to silence you. Don't allow them to silence you. Don't allow them to silence you.
No!
Now, for the Muslims in the crowd, not to exclude others, but there is a dynamic because of 9/11 to make us fearful and sit in our rooms, not to speak truth to power. It is time for you to stand up and speak truth to power. And don't allow people to make spiritual courtesy as a way to silence you from actually speaking what needs to be spoken and standing for justice that it needs to be stood with in solidarity with others. That is a commitment that we need to undertake, as well as other communities in solidarity with the Muslim community. History is made by people who spoke. We don't read in history about somebody that for 60 years didn't say a word. We hear about people that stood, one individual against a mighty world. We hear of Moses speaking against the Pharaoh. We speak of Jesus speaking against the Romans. We speak about Muhammad and all of the traditions that are there. They were one individual that spoke truth to power, and they were able to speak and change history. Don't be silent. If you're silent, you will not be able to change history. It is time for us to speak, and speak loud, and be consistent and deliberate. Assalamu alaikum.
The vine is my rap, she composed through a mind of attack and help lead the misled, from them blind in these tracks. Our roots only grow stronger when they try to erase the original of the land they can never replace. Our history's too rich, and our soil's our faith. Our identity never surrender, that'll be never our fate. By corruption or trust in false leadership, destruction of community to cover up the feet of it. Dreams blockaded like the road to peaceful aspirations, barbed wire, and no one can see past the apartheid war that snakes through the Holy Land, cutting off families so they can control the land, gentrifying Jerusalem to Judaize the last of it, crushing homes and the borders, and that's wherever they imagine it. The future is disastrous, from Gaza to the Nazareth. Killing of the indigenous should be seen as blasphemous. Zionists hijacked the religion, claiming biblical ties, but many real religious Jews will say they're living a lie. It just seems common sense. We didn't start this conflict. It's colonization justified. Now they're trying to take all of it. Call it what you will, but you will never respect it, because the blood is the water that the land's been blessed with. Free Palestine, everybody. Free Palestine. Power to the people. On the count of three.
But because Israel, from its conception, is a genocidal state. For 67 years, we have seen development and the evolution of an exclusionary movement that has killed and murdered, directly and indirectly, over 2 million people. 2 million of our people. It has exiled 7.1 million refugees to the West Bank, to Gaza, to Lebanon, to Jordan, to Syria, to Egypt, to all over the world. They have pursued our people in the surrounding countries, and they have attacked and destabilized the whole region. And it is for that reason that we must realize, and this is very important, for the people who have mobilized and come out here, not only here in San Francisco, but throughout the United States, because the United States is particularly complicit in the colonial project that's called the State of Israel. And what we must call for, number one, to end U.S. support to the apartheid State of Israel. The U.S. support to the apartheid State of Israel, not just because of this massacre, because 2 years from now there will be another massacre.
in a bombing that one to two of his friends, Hafiz Muhammad Hamad, 30 years old, an Islamic Jihad commander, was killed in the bombing of his home in Beit Hanin, along with five of his family members. Ibrahim Muhammad Hamad, 26 years old, died in the same bombing. Mehdi Muhammad Hamad, 46 years old, died in the same bombing. Fawzi Khalil Hamad, 62 years old, died in the same bombing. Dunya Bahdi Hamad, 16 years old, died in the same bombing. Suha Hamad, 25 years old, died in the same bombing. Sulaiman Salman Abu Sawin, 22 years old, also died in the same bombing. And we have a lot more.
Thank you. okay. You got me.
Been there since the beginning.
Thank you.
Next Saturday.